Hello and welcome to yet another tutorial by Davies Media Design. My name is Michael Davies, and in today's tutorial I'll be showing you how to remove the backgrounds of your images. And this is actually going to be an alternative method. I know there's a lot of methods out there already on how to do this. This is something that I have found to be the quickest method but the most efficient method, and I think there's a lot of methods out there that only work in certain cases. I think this method is going to work for a lot of you in most cases. But of course, before we get into that, I want to direct you guys over to my website at daviesmediadesign.com. As always, we have tons of GIMP video and text tutorials on here, so definitely check that out. You can also enroll in my GIMP 2.10 Masterclass from Beginner to Pro Photo Editing, which is a bestseller on Udemy. And you can support our channel and help us grow by becoming a patron on Patreon. And I'll include a link to this as well as all the relevant links from this tutorial in the description of the video. All right, so here is my final image that we're gonna be working on. This is GIMP version 2.10.10, by the way. And here is the original image. So as you can see, this image, you know, the lighting was pretty good, but the background had, we had this backdrop going on here, and then the backdrop just kind of ended based on the angle that the photographer decided to take for this particular photo. So we have the backdrop, and then we've got part of this brick wall here as well. And so we need to erase those elements because I think it looks a little bit sloppy. I mean, you can make the case that it looks kind of artsy this way, but I think it just, in the end, looks a little bit sloppy. And so we're gonna cut out everything around the subject here and only have the color backdrop here or the color background. And you can see right now I have a white background set up, but you can also have this as a light blue background here, or you know, whatever background color you want to use. I happen to use light blue and then also a dark blue here. So this method is going to use a combination of the foreground select tool, the paths tool, and layer masks. And it sounds like a lot of work, but trust me, it's going to be pretty quick and pretty easy. So let's go ahead and dive in here. So I'll start by opening up our original composition. So I'll go to File, and you guys will go to Open, but in my case, I'll go to Open Recent. And I'm gonna choose this file right here. I'm gonna post the link to this file in the description of the video, so definitely look for that. If I hold Control and zoom out here, we can see the full image. And this photo has a fairly simple background, so I know a lot of you out there look for tutorials on how to remove complex backgrounds. This technique will work for complex backgrounds as well, so bear with me here. But we're gonna start by adding a transparency layer to this. So I'm gonna right click on our image layer. I'm gonna go to Add Alpha Channel. That's just going to ensure that there is a transparency layer behind this image whenever we erase any part of it. Next, I'm gonna grab my foreground select tool over here from my toolbox. And you guys can copy my settings here. You'll see my radius is set to 3 for the feathered edges option. That's just going to make the edges of our selection area a little bit fuzzy so that they're not super hard edges. That's just gonna help things blend into one another here. And by the way, I have an entire tutorial dedicated to how to use the foreground select tool. So definitely check that out if you're not familiar with this tool. But again, you can copy all of my settings here. And I'm just going to start by outlining loosely the subject here. And this is going to allow me to separate the foreground object, which is the model, from the background. So I'll hit the Enter key. And now I'm going to increase the size of my brush using the brackets on my keyboard. And I'm actually gonna come over here and change our foreground color because that's gonna be the color that shows up here as we paint our foreground object. So I'm just gonna choose this red color I have here and click OK. Also, you wanna make sure the draw mode is set to draw foreground here, so I'll click on that. And now I'm going to click and drag my mouse to draw the foreground. So this is telling the algorithm that this is my foreground object. When you release your mouse, it should show up as the original picture below. If it shows up as this blue color, that means you just have to come over here and switch from draw background to draw foreground. I am loosely drawing the foreground object, but I do want to make sure that I get a decent amount of the details here so that the algorithm does a slightly better job of selecting the foreground object. All right, so I've loosely selected the foreground object. I'm gonna make sure that the engine here is set to matting leaven and also copy my settings right here. You guys can always play around with those settings if you don't get the final result you want. But once you're ready, hit the Enter key and you'll see the algorithm is going to attempt to select the foreground object here. So it's done a pretty good job. There's just a couple spots I gotta clean up real quick. I'll hold Control and zoom in. So you'll see there's some spots right here. I'm gonna decrease the size of my brush using the brackets on my keyboard and just make sure that this stuff does not get selected. So hold Control and zoom out. It's okay if it's not perfect. So we've got some parts right here, and these we could clean up in the next step as well. So again, don't worry too much about this selection area being perfect. So hold Control and zoom out. I think that's gonna be good enough for now. So now I'm gonna hit the Enter key. And for those of you who have a complex background, this part is going to be a little bit harder for you because the foreground select tool probably didn't do as good of a job of selecting the actual foreground object. So I'll show you how to clean that up here in a second. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna come over here to our paths dialog for the next step. And if you don't see your paths dialog, you can go to Windows, Dockable Dialogs, Paths. And now I'll come over here and choose my selection to path option here. So I'm gonna click on that. And you'll see that now our selection area that was drawn from the foreground select tool is over here in the shape of a path. So I can unhide that path and I'll hit Control Shift A to deselect that select area. And now you'll see there is a path going along our subject. Before you get frustrated, if your path is not as neatly around your subject as mine is, here's how we clean it up. We're gonna come over here and grab the paths tool. And then we're gonna click on this path here. So the reason I like using this method is you could see how many nodes it takes to draw a path cleanly like this. So the foreground select tool allows us to create a fairly clean selection area and then draw a complex path from that pretty quickly. So hold control and zoom in. So for this part, you're going to navigate around your image and you're gonna find any area that maybe deviates a little bit too far from the subject that you're trying to outline here. So hold control and zoom in. You can see there's some parts right here that are a little bit off. If I hold control and click and drag on the node, it's going to create a handle. I do have an entire tutorial dedicated to mastering the paths tool. So if you're not familiar with that, I recommend checking that out. And if I hold control and click on a line segment, that'll create a brand new node. So basically what you're doing is just going around this image here and you're going to adjust the path, hold control and drag to add some curves here. These are going to be handles that allow you to adjust the curves. So you're just adjusting this until you get everything a little bit more tidied up and a little bit more to your liking. Hold control and zoom in. And I do want to add for those of you looking for that quick fix, I mean, there are some tutorials out there if your photo has a lot of contrast already, but for the most part, there is no true quick fix to selecting complex shapes or selecting foreground objects that are set against a complex background. There are plenty of techniques out there and a lot of them work pretty well, but none of them are going to be, you know, a super quick solution to this problem of having a complex background. So there's just a lot less work with this than having to sit here and draw the entire path from scratch. All right, I'll hold control and zoom out. So I think we're pretty good there. It's not perfect, but I think it's going to do just fine for what we need it for. So next we're going to turn this back into a selection area. So we've adjusted it with the paths tool. Now we'll convert it back to a selection area. All you have to do is come over here and click selection from path while you're inside of your path tool. And that will once again turn that area into a selection. And now I'm gonna come back over here to our layers panel. And so we have our original layer here, and you'll remember that we put an alpha channel on this, so that added transparency. So now I'll right click and go to Add Layer Mask. And under Initialize Layer Mask 2, I'm going to choose Selection and click Add. And there you'll see our background will disappear, but we don't know really how good the edges are going to look after applying our layer mask. So let's check that out. We're going to change to a different tool, so we'll use the Move tool. I'll hit Control Shift A, and that's going to select none. And then I'm gonna come over to my path dialog and hide that path. So you can see there's a few spots here that need some work. And if I hold control and zoom in, you could see right here for sure there are some blue parts or some white parts here where you could see the original background. So if you wanna clean it up further, you can come over here and click this icon to switch your foreground and background colors to black and white. Then grab your paintbrush tool. And you're gonna wanna make sure you're on your actual layer mask here. So make sure you're on your layer mask, hold control and zoom in. So whenever you have black and you paint that on the layer mask, it's going to hide that object. And in this case, I wanna make sure I have a pretty good sized brush and that the hardness is turned down. So you can see the hardness slider here. Right now it's set to about 50%. So by painting on this layer mask, you can see it's allowing us to, and I'll hit control Z because I didn't do a good job there, but it's allowing us to refine this outline here and just really do away with any parts that maybe showed up that we didn't want to show up. And again, I'm not gonna spend too much time on this, just to keep this tutorial a decent length for you guys, a watchable length. But here you can see I'm getting rid of any parts here. And you guys can do this with hair or just with any real artifact that's showing up. And you can also do the opposite. So if I hit the X key on my keyboard, let's say I erased too much and I wanted to bring it back, I can always paint it back in by painting white on the layer mask. But I'll hit Control Z to undo that because I do want that gone. I'll hold Control and zoom out. There is a white part right here, and I actually left that in the original edit because it kind of looks like light that's sort of shining off the hair. So I decided to just leave that in. So I'll hold Control and zoom out. And now we have our model here with the background removed, or the subject here. So now I'm going to add a new background behind it. And to do that, I'll create a new layer. And I'm going to name this one White Background and click OK. And now I'm going to click and drag this below our original image layer here. And now I'm going to come over here and I'm going to change this black color to more of an off-white color and click OK. So now we have white and off-white. And now I'm going to grab my gradient tool here, and I have the shape set to radial, and I have the color here set to foreground and background. You can go with HSV or RGB, doesn't really matter. And now I'm going to click and drag this, and you can always swap the colors if you want. So I like the lighter white in the middle and radiating out to the darker white or the off-white. And you can also adjust the gradient here. So I'll go with that right there and hit the Enter key. I do like having a gradient background behind the subject because I feel like it emulates a studio lighting environment where perhaps it's not entirely evenly lit. But next, I want it to appear as if the light hitting the subject's face is casting a shadow on our backdrop that we created here. So in order to do that, I'm going to come over here back to the Paths dialog, and I'm going to click this button right here, Path to Selection, and that's going to outline our subject again. So I'll come back over here to the Layers panel. And now I'm going to create a new layer, and I'm just going to name this Shadow, and click OK. And for now, I'm going to bring the shadow above our main layer here. And now I'm going to switch to the Bucket Fill tool, and I'm going to click on this icon here to change this color back to black. And I'm going to fill in the selection area with that black, and then hit Control-Shift-A to deselect that. Now I'm going to hit M on my keyboard, or click right here to grab my Move tool, and I'm just going to offset this shadow a little bit here, like so. And then I'm going to click and drag the shadow layer below our main image layer. So obviously that looks super fake, so we're going to make it look a little bit more realistic by going to Filters, Blur, Gaussian Blur. And I'm just going to crank the blur up on here. So we're going to crank it up quite high, and I'll click OK. You can also decrease the opacity here of this to help it blend in a little bit more. And if you want it to appear as if the subject's a little bit further away, you can also come over here and grab the Scale tool and click on your shadow layer and just scale it down a little bit. And just make sure you also reposition it so it's moved over a bit. And I'll click Scale. So the last thing I'm gonna do is I'm going to use the Dodge and Burn tool to help blend some of these shadows that's going on with our subject so that we don't see so much of the lines from where we cut the subject out. So I'm gonna come over here to our main image layer, and then I'll come over here to the Dodge and Burn tool. And I turn my opacity of this tool down to around 50%. And I have a pretty soft brush here, so this is set to 50. I'm going to make sure that my type here is set to burn. And I'm going to increase the size of my brush. And now I'm just going to paint a few strokes here. And that's just going to allow the edges of our subject to blend into the shadows here. And it just makes it look a little bit more realistic. If you think it's a little bit too dark on the other side, you can always switch over to Dodge and do the opposite, so that'll make this lighter. I'm going to hit Control-Z though, because I don't feel I need to do that for this particular photo. So that is basically it. You can always go back and add a different color background if you want. And if you need to adjust the outline around your subject, you can always paint on the layer mask to refine that line. But other than that, that's it. It's a pretty simple technique. Now I can export my photo, so I'll just go to File, Export As. And of course, you can name this whatever you want. I'll just rename this something else. And I'll hit Export. All right, so that's it for this tutorial. Hopefully you liked it. If you did, you could subscribe to my YouTube channel at youtube.com/DaviesMediaDesign. You can visit our website at daviesmediadesign.com. You can enroll in my best-selling GIMP 2.10 Masterclass from beginner to pro photo editing. And you could support our channel and help us grow by becoming a patron on Patreon. And I'll include a link to that as well as all the relevant links from this tutorial in the description of the video. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.